For those of you joining us just now, we have been upstaged this morning by KPCC. So Professor Carter has come straight from there to this lecture. One of the laments that I have heard over the last number of years has been that we no longer have in our society, in American society, public philosophers who speak out of a Christian perspective. So people hark back to the days of Reinhold Niebuhr and others from that generation who were known as people who thought seriously about issues of the day. But I have noticed in the last several years that there is a successor to those earlier worthies, and certainly Professor Carter is the person who most readily comes to mind as one who is addressing important issues of the day and doing so from a different angle than most of us are accustomed to thinking about them, namely from a law or a legal point of view, together with a profound Christian commitment. And so I have found his influence, his writings, very influential, and I'm certainly grateful that he is speaking out in our public life today. Since we're a bit short on time, I'm not going to tarry longer. Professor Carter comes to us from Yale Law School. You have seen a list of his books that he has published, and those books are available for purchase out in the lobby. So we'll proceed now with the third and final lecture in this series, Parallel Institutions and Other Alternatives to Politics. Professor Carter.
Well, good morning. I'm sorry that I was a little late this morning, but I gather it was found possible to fill the time. Everybody's feeling good, very up. So now I have to try to follow that. I don't play the piano. I don't preach well, so I'm going to have to read my paper instead. It's been an interesting couple of days for me to be here at Fuller and in the Fuller community. And I've found that people here have been enormously welcoming and friendly and open. And I've found a remarkable diversity of views about Christianity, about the Christian life among students and among faculty as well. And you don't always find this at seminaries, which often tend to be typed in ways that where people choose to spend time among people who already agree with them on everything. And that's been a very exciting aspect of my visit. But it's also relevant to what I'm going to talk about today, because if you remember, those of you who survived the first two lectures yesterday, that my theme has been on the role of religion in politics. And while I've defended as important to both religion and democracy the active participation of religious people, religious institutions, and religious voices in our various public debates and in the public square, I've been more critical of religious organizations that try and affect to be kingmakers to choose who the leaders of the secular governmental arm ought to be. This morning, I'm going to talk a little bit about alternatives to politics. And it's important to have that conversation now because a lot of religious people and a lot of Christians or turning away from politics, turning away even from engagement in the culture, returning to an earlier understanding of the Christian life, certainly on the evangelical side of the Christian life, an understanding in which, thank you, sure, an understanding in which the world is left to its own devices as long as it doesn't interfere with people's ability to lead the lives they believe that God wants them to lead. I'm going to talk a little bit about today about some of those alternatives and also about some alternatives to the alternatives. And time permitting, I'll talk about alternatives to the alternatives to the alternatives. I have to put it that way because those of you who were raised and educated as didactically as I are aware that there must always be exactly two alternatives. When you have three, there are options or choices, but one thing they are not is alternatives. A little more than a year ago, in February of 1999, Paul Weyrich, the head of the Free Congress Foundation and one of the principal founders of a number of the organizations of conservative Christianity, notably both Moral Majority and Christian Coalition, wrote a very interesting letter to his supporters, a letter that ended up in the newspapers. What he wrote in complaint that although he felt in the 90s that Christian conservatives had indeed, as he put it, gotten our people elected, that was his phrase, that did not result in the adoption of the agenda for which they were pushing. And Weyrich explained this to his supporters by saying that he and others who had founded some of these institutions had been wrong on a principal point in their analysis. Namely, he said that there was, in fact, no moral majority, by which he meant people who viewed, as Lucy Meade was pointing out last night, who viewed life the way that he and his supporters did. Now, one might say that these organizations have been good or bad for America or for politics. That's not my purpose here. My purpose is to understand his complaint and his solution. He said there was no moral majority. He said the nation had fallen into the hands, and all the powerful institutions had fallen into the hands of the enemy. And he named specifically the public schools, the federal government, the media, the courts, and most churches as they had fallen into the hands of the enemy. He added, I believe that we probably have lost the culture war. Now, that is a rather significant concession on the part of one of those who for years had been talking about the importance of fighting the culture war and for years had been insisting that there was somewhere an elite that was controlling things, and if the elite could but be overthrown, the majority who held traditional values would come to hold sway. But Weyrich wrote this immediately after the Senate decided not to remove Bill Clinton from office, and he wrote in his letter that if there were a moral majority, that Bill Clinton would no longer be president of the United States. The issue here is not whether one agrees or disagrees with his analysis. The issue instead is what Weyrich proposed to do about this. And what he believed that believers ought to do is to withdraw in large measure from this hostile culture that he described. To withdraw. Now, when I say withdraw, or when he said withdraw, he seemed to mean this quite seriously. He spoke of parents sending their children not only to religious schools, but in fact of forming, in effect, small communities that would feature even their own courts, which has been a hot issue, some of you know, in constitutional law, especially up in the Pacific Northwest. They would form even their own courts as a way of escaping the effects of the culture that was now the enemy. Because otherwise, he feared it would be impossible to build community, to build family, to raise children in a way that was consistent with the particular religious vision, particular Christian vision, that had supported Weyrich's work in the past. Now, as you know from my remarks last night, I'm a great believer in the proposition that Christians should spend more time in the garden and less in the wilderness. And so, whatever may be my political differences with Weyrich, there's a part of his analysis that certainly appeals to me. Moreover, of course, there is nothing new in his argument. Dissenting evangelical preachers in the United States have insisted for 200 years that Christians should depart from the culture of depravity and lead their lives in a way that minimized their contacts with a larger world viewed as sinful. Of course, in the late 20th century, and we Christians know we're still in the late 20th century, right? It's not the 21st century yet. In the late 20th century, where we're accustomed to living in a world that is not only diverse, but in important ways integrated and interconnected, Warwick's advice may sound a little unusual, a little odd to contemporary ears. Yet it has a certain appeal. And I think it ought to have an appeal not only to the religious, but in fact it ought to have an appeal to students of politics for the following reason. That one of the things that keeps democratic politics vibrant is precisely our genuine differences across a variety of issues. We do not have, and I hope do not want, a nation in which everyone agrees all the time. But it is the work of American culture today, as it has always been the work of American culture, to engage in a process of leveling, to try to create a world in which people largely think alike. Religion, in my judgment, especially religion that is genuine in the sense that it's truly transformative, religion is one of the last bastions of difference in America, one of the last bastions of the formation of the genuinely, radically distinct human personality. And it strikes me that the formation of that radically different personality is something that we ought to value in America and nurture and support. And so to the extent there are religious dissenters who want to go off and build their own gardens in which they're going to raise their children, in which they're going to create meaning, meaning often at sharp variance from the dominant meaning of a variety of things in society, that seems to be something, pardon me, that ought to be applauded. Without regard to the reasons for it, without regard to the particular ideas that are going to be inculcated in separate communities, that the communitarian instinct, in this sense, is a good thing for democracy, at least if we want people who are genuinely different. Now, we might decide we want a different kind of democracy. We want a democracy in which it becomes impossible to express certain ideas because no one will ever think of them because of the way everyone's been trained. But I consider that an extraordinarily dangerous ideological idea, one that's been tried various places in the world with more or less success, but always with enormous human destruction and misery. And I think we Americans often make the mistake of thinking that we are somehow beyond all that. We're beyond ideology, and the lessons we would like all young people to learn are naturally, clearly, the right ones, and therefore parents shouldn't be in the business of dissenting. And whenever I hear that argument, I remember my days in junior high school in the public schools of Washington, D.C., in which we were taught, according to what was then the accepted historical faith, according to Samuel Eliot Morrison, that the slaves in the antebellum South were basically happy and only a few hotheads and agitators actually wanted to be free. But it seems to me that the Wyrick letter does not go far enough. In fact, it may go slightly in the wrong direction because his view seems to be of Christians retreating into these communities in a sense of we're going to take our marbles and go home, or waiting for a more appropriate moment to venture out into the wilderness. Whereas I believe that one of the reasons it's so important to nurture these communities is precisely because the wilderness needs them. The wilderness needs those differences. The wilderness needs genuine and very radical diversity. Which is one of the reasons that I think that there's another alternative that we don't talk about enough. It's what I refer to in my book as the gift of time. Time is our only non-renewable resource. We're all marching at exactly the same rate through time. We can't get it back. You reach a certain age and you begin to wonder where it all went as it spins out behind you instead of in front of you. But wherever it comes from and wherever it goes, and those of you who follow contemporary physics may know the recent theory about how time is actually an illusion, that what we have is an infinite set of simultaneously existing quantum states, And our navigation of those simultaneously existing states is what gives rise to the illusion of time. I'm not really lifting my hand. There's one quantum state which is down, one in which it's up, and they simply exist at the same time. And the only way I can make sense of them is to pretend that I've changed the position of my hand, or is actually my consciousness has simply moved from one quantum state to another. Well, I don't really buy that argument. I do believe there's such a thing as time, and I know that I don't seem ever to have enough of it. And it seems to me that whether we build alternative communities or not, what we do need to build is ways of having more time. And when I say time, I mean time for a certain kind of thoughtfulness. One of the great weaknesses in America is our inability, our famous inability to engage in argument with each other. We're very good at citing our conclusions to each other and yelling and screaming at the one who has a different conclusion. But actually carrying on the discussion, the conversation, is very hard. Some people say it's because we don't have time to argue, but I think it's also because we don't have time to think. That is, our conclusions themselves are often ill-reasoned or unreasoned. I resist the term knee-jerk, but you know what I mean. It's striking that if you read the Socratic dialogues, it's striking how often, when asked a hard question, Socrates, instead of just announcing the answer, stops to think. Plato writes this over and over again. Here, Socrates paused to think. Imagine that. Imagine that when you're asked a difficult question, you realize that it's difficult, called a difficult question because it's a difficult question, and you have to think about it. We don't live lives in ways that give us time to think. And this is especially hard on the Christian life, where so much of our time should be spent in prayer and meditation. I was reading recently the work of one famous theologian who said that it is his goal to spend at least 1 hour alone with God every day, except on days when he's very busy, and then he spends 2 hours with God every day. And that's an attitude I think that we see all too rarely. Mother Teresa was once quoted, or she was once asked by a reporter, when you pray to God, what do you say? And she said, I don't say anything, I just listen. And the reporter said, what does God say to you? He said, he doesn't say anything, he just listens. Now, when you think about that, it makes, from the Christian point of view, an enormous amount of sense to spend time just listening, clearing the mind, but it takes time. And people of deep faith, and certainly Christians, ought to be trying to organize our lives in ways that enable us to be thoughtful, enable us to take time. The notion of being too busy for God is an increasing problem in many a Christian community, and one that has to be resisted. Because in the end, it makes no difference whether one lives in the culture or on the fringe of the culture or rejects the culture if one isn't building a relationship with God as part of daily work. The problem is that we live in a culture that not only doesn't value the taking of time, it often penalizes the taking of time. I was just on this radio program, which I very much enjoyed this morning, as was mentioned. But there's something about radio, if you think about it, there's always something going on, you know, that producers hate dead air, as it's called. Somebody has to be talking all the time. You cannot pause to think. It's not allowed. It's not part of what's done. Meaning you have to think of all your answers in advance or make them up on the spot without the opportunity to be morally thoughtful. Our culture in standardized testing rewards those who think fast more than those who think best. The student who can solve this problem immediately is rewarded ahead of the student who might take half an hour to solve it, even though the second student might be the more morally thoughtful of the two, but gets pushed to the bottom of the academic food chain because not quick enough, you see. So much of our society says, don't be thoughtful, hurry up, rush. I was listening to a Christian radio program the other day, and the host was talking about Christians praying for patience. Dear Lord, give me patience and give it to me right now. You know, and there is that aspect to life, even to Christian life. And it strikes me that in a way, this is more important than any particular political battle or any particular electoral battle, because it goes to the heart of what it means to be Christian. It goes to the heart of how we live our lives. So that to be active on an important issue, whatever it may seem like a good thing, but it can be so passionate and consuming that we lose touch with our obligation to lead the Christian life in the midst of our activism. And what's really quite striking is you see this even in the ending of any sense of Sabbath. You know, people bring home briefcases full of work on the weekend, or they sit at their computers working on the weekend and even on Sunday for Sunday Sabbatarians, and often on Saturday for Saturday Sabbatarians, people find themselves working on that day. I mean, so God rested on the seventh day, but our work is much too important, you see, for us to rest on the seventh day. We have to get it done. There's no sense of time as something that is God's gift, non-renewable, to be used for God's purposes. And it strikes me that unless we can somehow recover time, transform our understanding of time so that it belongs not to work, not to the employer, not to the university, not to the government, and not to us, but rather to God, so we must be faithful stewards of it, because you can't get more of it. Unless we get that sense, the rest of what we try to do in our Christian lives will slowly lose its meaning, because we will lose our thoughtfulness. Now, I also think that Wyrick was right on another point, however. When he talked in his letter about alternative institutions, it strikes me that he is very close to some important truths about the Christian life. A lot of Christians choose to send their children to Christian schools instead of public schools or other private schools that they might choose. And I think that for parents, families who feel so moved, this is a perfectly, indeed, an excellent thing to do. I'm not saying every Christian is called to do this, and Wyrick in his letter insists that every Christian ought to send their children to Christian schools. And this is a proposition with which I forcefully disagree. But I do think that it's important that we protect and nurture the freedom of those who make that choice. It hasn't always been protected as a freedom in America. I was mentioning to some of you at breakfast that there used to be a lot of aid, government aid to private religious schools in America until the late 19th century, when Catholic schools were established in America. And then suddenly people discovered, that is, made up a constitutional principle that said it's unconstitutional to give aid to religious schools. For the first 100 years of our nation, no one had any trouble doing it, but suddenly it became unconstitutional when it was Catholic schools. And indeed, the anti-Catholic bias, I should say parenthetically, explains a lot of our law about church and state, because there are all sorts of things that we never discovered were forbidden by the Constitution until Roman Catholics began to do them. The argument against religious education became so intense in the late 19th and early 20th centuries that states began to adopt laws that made it illegal for parents to send their children to religious schools. That is, the compulsory attendance laws themselves, while in part motivated by an admirable progressive sense of the need for a well-educated populace, were also in part motivated by the desire to wean the immigrant children away from their parents. That helps explain some of the curriculum of the schools of that era. If you haven't studied it, it's worth your time to look at. But then, when Catholic parents, and to some extent Jewish parents, objected to the content of the public school curriculum and established separate religious schools of their own, some of the states began to respond by enacting laws making it illegal to send children to private schools, at least without the permission of the state. And these laws were often described as simply further explanations of what was meant in the compulsory schooling laws. Compulsory schooling meant compulsory public schooling. Now, I tell you this story for the following reason. The Supreme Court in 1925 held those anti-private school laws unconstitutional. And in holding them unconstitutional, the court argued that the laws interfered with the fundamental freedom of the family to choose the educational upbringing of their children. That is a fundamental freedom in which I still believe, and which I think for which I think religious people ought to be fighting, even though it is one that is often, I fear, ignored or trivialized. Educational battles, as all of you know, battles over the content of curriculum, battles over vouchers, are often far more heated than battles over a variety of other divisive social issues. And it's pretty easy to see why. Because when you are talking about education, the future is at stake. You're talking about the raising up of children. You're talking about the training of children. You're talking about who is going to be able to control what children learn. My own view is quite strongly that the final judgment rests in parents, that in particular, that the judgments of professional educators, while admirable and excellent, should not trump the judgment of parents. The judgment of democracy perhaps can trump the judgment of parents at times. That is, if we decide democratically there are certain things children must learn, that's a very different matter than someone deciding for reasons of educational theory there's things that children must learn. I mean, a different matter democratically. But put that to one side. My point here is simply to say that one of the freedoms for which religious people should fight is the freedom of others to make educational decisions for their children. Now, this almost always raises the question of vouchers. Not one, don't want to get into that question very much today, although I'll be happy to talk about it in questions and answers, except to say that if we're going to protect the freedom of parents to make decisions about the education of their children, it's hard to figure out how we're going to extend it to poor parents the same freedom that I have as a middle-class parent unless we supply them the wherewithal with which to do it. And I know there are those who think that vouchers for education would be unconstitutional, but it strikes me that there's no constitutional difference between giving money to parents of a 12th grader to go to a religious school and giving money to parents of a college freshman to go to a religious school. And the second of that we do with public money all the time. But that's not something you need to get into. The point is that freedom itself, because the freedom of parents to make those judgments rests on a larger conception of what religious freedom is. It is not properly understood, I think, is a freedom that's about individual choice. We can decide what religion to be. That's certainly true. We can decide that, but the Christian tradition is otherwise. The Christian tradition is we don't choose God, and God chooses us. And so it strikes me, and the Jewish tradition is quite similar. So it strikes me that it's important for religious people to resist any understanding of religious freedom that rests principally on the notion that changing a religion is like changing a shirt or changing a skirt, that it is simply something you choose because you feel this way today and you might feel some other way tomorrow. I mention this because there's a terrible, well, terrible is too strong a word, there's a disappointing Supreme Court decision entitled The State of Thornton versus Caldor, decided perhaps a decade ago. That case held unconstitutional a Connecticut statute that required employers to allow their employees to take their Sabbath day off. That was the statute. Now, why was it unconstitutional? Well, there were a variety of reasons given by the court. I want to mention only one, which Justice O'Connor mentioned in a separate opinion. She said that everybody would probably like to have the freedom to choose their day off. What this suggests about religious choice is that what one does, if in a state like Connecticut that had that law, is you say, well, what day would I like to have off from work? Okay, what are the religions that have that as a Sabbath day? Well, that's the religion for me. And that's the kind of bizarre argumentation in which we inevitably get bound up when we visualize religious freedom as basically being a variety of individualism. I think it isn't. I think religious liberty really we should understand as referring to not the religious individual, although that matters too, but the religion itself. The idea of a religion, a group, even an institution, is the thing that in some sense is free to move at certain times and in certain ways. And if we understand that, it's easier to see how parents making choices for their children can be a part of religious freedom rather than a part of some kind of generalized notion of parental right or obligation. Now, I know we started late, and I'm going to run short of time, but I do want to mention two other rather different notions of things other than politics, the religious sense. The Puritans made a mistake in analysis, I think, several hundred years ago. When arriving on these shores, the first thing they did in a number of their communities was to forbid preachers from performing marriages. Marriages had to be done by a justice of the peace or by a judge. Now, the reason for that historically is easy to understand. It was because the Church of England had such a stranglehold over marriage in England at the time that there were all sorts of abuses that occurred because of the power the church had. But the Puritans made the error of thinking that if they simply took this power from the church and turned it over to the state, that would solve the problem of what marriage was and how it would be protected and nurtured. Their error was in supposing that their background moral and religious understanding would remain the background moral and religious understanding for all time. In other words, that every state would be like the state as they understood it. It strikes me that religious groups have too much respect for state laws regarding marriage. And I mean that quite sincerely. When my wife and I were married, one of the things that the priest kept reminding us to do was to get our license, as though somehow the church couldn't perform the wedding without the state's permission. And when you think about it, there's something quite bizarre about that, but the power to perform marriages is treated in government as delegated to religious officials and others by the state, so that it's really the state that authorizes marriages. But if you have a biblical view of marriage, that doesn't really make any sense. It doesn't make any sense. It's a very dangerous doctrine because it suggests that marriage is whatever the state says marriage is rather than whatever the church says marriage is. Now you might say, but wait a minute, we have so many different churches, so many different religions, so many different religious views. What do you mean whatever the church says? Well, imagine as a thought experiment, this is not a formal proposal, at least not yet, but imagine as a thought experiment, suppose that we said that, that's fine. Every religious group, every private organization, they can perform any kind of marriages they want. The state doesn't regulate marriage, has no interest in marriage, gives no penalties for marriage, gives no rewards for marriage. Marriage is what this church or Joe's Marriage Shop Incorporated on the corner says it is, and therefore this church can ignore entirely the marriages performed by Joe on the corner, and Joe can ignore entirely, if he prefers, the marriages performed by this church, because the significance is not an official significance. It is significance for Christians, for example, a significance within Christian community. And that's where it matters. It strikes me that this is another aspect of a parallel institution. Churches taking the view that we don't care what the state says about marriage. We're going to do marriages our way and give them our meaning, and that's all that there is going to be to it. It's a thought experiment, one I've given a lot of thought to, although I won't burden you with too much of it here. I want to mention a fifth alternative, which is Christians who are unhappy with the culture voting not so much in the ballot box, but with their dollars. It's really quite striking, you know, a friend of mine, I mentioned this at lunch to some people yesterday, a friend of mine, David Saperstein, who's a Reformed Jewish rabbi, likes to explain, he explains his opposition to the posting of the Ten Commandments in schoolrooms and other official places this way. He said, I want Christians to show me that any Christian has ever spent a dollar differently because it has God's name on it than it would have been spent if it didn't have God's name on it. He thinks that God's name on money has caused God's name to be taken in vain, in effect, as people consistently ignore the fact that it's there as they use this item that happens to contain God's name. Very interesting notion. You see, a very interesting notion. It strikes me that people of faith, and certainly Christians, should be thoughtful about spending money as we're thoughtful about other things. We should be thoughtful about, it's not so much a matter of organized boycotts, although that's fine, but really individual and communal thoughtfulness. Because sometimes we change our spending patterns because we want to change somebody's behavior, you know. And so, for example, when the Southern Baptists called for a boycott of Disney World, and people said, well, gee, people kept going to Disney World, therefore the call was a failure. Well, that's interesting. It's a very instrumental view of what's a success and what's a failure. If the argument is that it was a failure because it was an effort to change Disney's corporate policies on a matter of issues, that is absolutely correct. Yes, judged by that caliber, a failure. But you can view these things another way. Is the success of Christian living the success in changing the world, or the success in living according to God's word? I might say there's a particular merchant or a particular place where I will not spend money because I have moral objections to what that person is doing, knowing that I'm not going to change that person, and yet believing this is what God requires of me. It strikes me that being thoughtful about how we spend dollars is also a kind of alternative living in a world in which so many people are thoughtless about how they spend dollars. Because what all of these suggestions, and I know I've gone over them briefly, but I want to honor the 11 o'clock classes, what all of these suggestions have in common is at their heart, they reflect an idea that's precious to me, that should be precious, I think, to people of faith generally, and that certainly motivates my writing on this area. Religious communities ought to be communities of resistance against the culture. Religious communities should never be fully at peace with the world in which they live. I mentioned yesterday that Romans 12:2 is over on the wall of the prayer garden and ought to be taken quite seriously, it strikes me, by Christians. Because to be called to be Christian, to be touched by God, is to be called to be different than you would be, than we would be, if not called to be Christian. A religion that makes no difference, that works no transformation in human life, is hardly worthy of the term religion. We might call it a neat idea instead. But religion that does transform is inevitably political. It's political because it affects who we are and how we see the world, and therefore changes our interaction with the world. So religion will always be in politics as long as religious people always take religion seriously. And listing all these alternatives, I'm suggesting other ways to think about how to struggle with a culture that may not reflect one's view of what the world should be, without necessarily saying what I really want is to have my hands on the lever of power in that culture. Historically, Christians with their hands on the levers of power have been no better than people of other faiths or people of secular thinking, and often much worse. That's not to defend secular people with their hands on the lever of power. More people have died in the secular wars of the 20th century than in all the religious wars of history combined, and by a significant factor. But at the same time, religions cannot point to history and say, look how well we've done, we've been running things. Theocracy in American, in world history has almost always been a bad idea. So the difficult tightrope that people of faith need to walk in a democracy, but I would argue in other forms of government as well, is not merely how to be in the world but not of it, but it's also how to live true to one's faith, try to change what's going on in God's creation to improve it, while at the same time resisting the temptation, as I said yesterday, to cash in that delicious power to die for the faith, for the power to kill for the faith. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed, Professor Carter. It strikes me that the time we spent waiting for you in worship, led by Benjamin Robinson, was time well invested, and you followed on very well. in tying the two together. So thank you very much. We have a request here to bring to your attention. This is from Peggy Johnson. Her husband, Jimmy, underwent surgery at Huntington Memorial Hospital, and it went well, for which we give thanks. Now, we're going to take a brief stretch break, and by brief I mean 3 or 4 minutes only, and then we want you to come back, and Professor Robert Johnston will give a response, after which there will be opportunity for discussion with you as audience participating.
One of the things that Professor Carter said when he started the lecture yesterday morning, I guess it was, and he said that you need to be able to think about two contraries at the same time, which is actually a very sophisticated theory of aesthetics. I don't know if you know that, but there's been a lot of writing about sophisticated aesthetics that say that's exactly what artists do. They have to think about two opposite things and hold them in their mind at the same time. And he's also used the image of play, that that we need to think about things as a kind of game, and the outcome of which is a very important and serious issue. And so I think it's important and significant that the respondent today is an expert on play, who's written his doctoral dissertation on a theology of play. And Robert K. Johnston is our professor of theology and culture, and we'll look forward to hearing from him a response, and to which perhaps Dr. Carter will have a brief response, and perhaps to which you also will have some response, and we'll give you opportunity to go to the mic and ask your questions or to continue the conversation as you wish. Dr. Johnston.
Bill is taller than I am. What a feast we've had these three lectures. I've certainly enjoyed it greatly. My daughter is just about to begin law school at the University of Minnesota. And given all the lawyer jokes, I've had some concern about that. But we've heard not only an eloquent lawyer, but an eloquent Christian lawyer. And it's enriched us all. It isn't just society that rewards fast thinking. It's also lectureships. And so after hearing the results of years of reflection on very fundamental issues, I'm asked to say something profound off the cuff. Maybe reflection or large spaces of air, since this isn't a radio show, would be better for us all. As Bill said, I teach theology and culture, but I do it not from the social sciences, but from the humanities. And I think it was accidental, but providential for me, that I was asked to respond to the third lecture. I want to begin where you would expect for me to begin, with Professor Carter's comments on the gift of time. It's hard to do as finals approach. Most of us listened to that with some earnestness, didn't we? We need more time in the garden, less time in the wilderness. And as a society, that's true. Our work week is up to 44 hours plus and growing. We work longer hours than any other industrialized nation. Lawyers at large firms in Chicago, their first year out of grad school, make $125,000. But in order for the firms to remain solvent, that means they need to bill at 40 billable hours per young lawyer, which means you need to work at least 80 hours a week. do we jump on that treadmill? 76% of us respond by saying there's great stress in our lives. I think of Jesus' comments in John 10. The poor you'll have with us always. How scandalous. What an insensitive comment. No, not really. That's the one thing people usually don't say about Jesus. He was consistently sensitive to the outcast, the hurting, the poor. But the comment's response was to Judas, who had said, "Why didn't Mary take that perfume and sell it and give the money to the poor?" And Jesus says there's a time for politics, but there's also a time for praise and friendship. There's a time for work. There's a time to renew the spirit. Life needs a balance. Jung, the psychologist, is reported to have had a client once who was a minister, had great anxiety, and Jung listened to his story and then said to him, "I want you to go home and I want you to do nothing for 2 hours every day." And the minister didn't much like the advice, but said okay and left. He came back for his next session some weeks later, and he said, "Oh, doctor, that was the best advice you could have given me. It was glorious to sit there 2 hours every day and listen to Mozart." And Jung looked at him and said, "No, I told you to do nothing." And the minister all of a sudden was quite agitated, and he said, "Oh, doctor, I couldn't stand to be alone with myself for that long." To which Jung said, "Think of how the members of your church each Sunday must feel." Or think of the Trappist monks in Snowmass. 17 of them. Brother Keating is one of them who's gone around the world teaching centering prayer. In order for them to earn a living, they raise chickens and sell eggs. And because they're simple people, they eat eggs. Lots of eggs. The average was 27 eggs a week. Well, when researchers discovered that, they said, "This is a wonderful sample." And they immediately went to the monastery to test for cholesterol and to figure out what was going on. Only for them to discover that the highest cholesterol reading of any of the monks was 130. You see, if you have your life together, if your vows are half work and half reflection, you can eat eggs. The gift of time. I could keep going. I'm an enthusiastic gardener. Though you just heard my wife chuckle. That's as Professor Carter was using it metaphorically. But I also worry a little about that gardening. Professor Carter did too, but I want to emphasize that. His alternative to the alternative suggested that the escape that we're looking for from the wilderness is not escape. The removal from politics is not an apolitical act, but it's an alternate political act in radical community with discipline and reflection. But the New York Times Magazine last week polled a wide section of us and then reflected on the way we live now, particularly with regard to our inner lives. And though 79% of us said we are religious, that garden is important, we also said we didn't want a strong God or strong rules. We want to decide for ourselves what's right, good, and meaningful. Half of us believe that the best religion is one that's borrowed from all religions in terms of personal choice and combination. Or the Newsweek magazine last week, the same, talked about who we are as teenagers. 22 million teenagers, ages 13 to 19 in this country. And that their conclusion was that those teenagers are openly passionate about religion. Wow, we might think that's good news. We got a lot of people tending the garden. But then it goes on to say that those 78% are passionately religious, less than half of those regularly attend a religious service, and it's shrinking each year. In fact, they'd rather call themselves spiritual than religious. God is amorphous. 50% believe that all religions are equally valid. Tolerance, meaning acceptance, is sacrosanct. Professor Carter's vision that he's given so splendidly these last 2 days and eloquently this morning is closest structurally, theologically, to the Anabaptist position. But there, rigor, discipline, community, reflection, theology, all are central. You know, I fear that for many of Professor Carter's listeners, the garden that we go to is one filled with weeds. If the wilderness is barren, the garden is self-absorbed and absorbing. No monastic disciplines here. We just go for the weekends to those retreats and dabble. No communal discernment or correction. I won't judge you if you don't judge me. No commitment to an organized group. We just switch churches, don't we? Almost at will. And if we're not committed, we never are disappointed. Perhaps both the garden and the wilderness are dangerous. And yet God calls us to both. When I reflect on Scripture, we're called to work and play, to speak and to listen, to politics and to meditation, to service and to Sabbath, to power and to powerlessness. Jesus not only accepted the perfume, he overturned the money changers. And I suspect Professor Carter agrees with me. I'm speaking more about the reader, the hearer. It's reader analysis that I'm really about in this first comment. I'm concerned that evangelicals, with our history of quietism, our blindness to social injustice, will use that garden imagery with its walls, will use the taking time to not engage the wilderness with anything more than a tiny cup of water. When I ask students to read Stanley Hauerwas's books, and I do that, I think they're wonderful. And Professor Carter referred to Hauerwas a couple times in his first lecture. There's affinities there. I say to them, it's a prophetic word to establishment Methodists. But be careful, it's not necessarily a prophetic word to you. Why is it scandalous for so much of the mainline church, what Hauerwas is saying? But it's singing to the choir for so many evangelicals. Because we really don't get it. We only say in the sense Jesus didn't mean it. The poor will be with you always. One final comment. My fear increases somewhat when Professor Carter speaks of the power of the purse. In his manuscript, he labels that also being political through boycotts. And you could see homeschooling as one form of boycott activity. Here it's not really being apolitical for conservative Christians, but selectively political, isn't it? But again, my question is, who we boycott, why we boycott, how we know we should boycott. And again, the alternative to the alternative that Professor Carter gave this morning, the need to be reflective, to do it from out of a measured and reasoned center, is wise advice. Teaching in the area of theology and film, and Professor Carter alludes to that in his manuscript. The church doesn't have a good track record with regard to thoughtful, reflective boycotts. Typically, we've said, we saw the script, we see the actors, we don't need to see the movie, it must be bad. That's what the Catholic Church did with Dogma in New York. That's what we did as evangelicals with The Last Temptation of Christ in 1988. We said, oh, it's scandalous that that movie shows Jesus having a sexual affair. Don't confuse us with the facts that the movie actually shows Jesus on the cross, tempted with the temptation of being normal like you and I, of falling in love, getting married, having a family, growing old. And that Jesus then resists that temptation and dies on the cross because that's his vocation. You see, the boycott was counterproductive because it simply showed us in our unreflective, non-engaged, reactionary worst. And too often, that's the case. I'm also concerned, and with this I'll open it to you because you need the time. I'm concerned also even about boycotts with schools. I understand what Professor Carter says, that parents should have the choice and that education of their children resides with them. Most of you don't know me at that personal level, but when we had to make choices for our children, we went where there were good public schools, and not everyone has that opportunity. Some people are living in situations where there's only bad schooling options. But I was also, with Lou Smeads, involved in Pasadena, when Pasadena simply had segregated schoolings. And we resisted, because we thought neighborhood schools were best, any sort of busing. And some of us liberals said, oh, we should have integrated schools. And we applauded when the courts took over and forced integration. And what happened was, all the Christians started their alternative schools and took their kids out of the public schools. And the school system went from 95th or 96th percentile to down in the 20s. The price we pay for alternate schooling in our current political system
Some brief comments?
Yeah, very brief. I really agree with nearly everything that Professor Johnston said. I do want to maybe mention two small points of difference, or points that I would like to think a little more. First, on the very last point about the schools, I think that I see what's going on in the schools differently than a lot of people do. I was telling some of you yesterday that, take one example, I don't consider these big suburban schools public schools. People call them public schools, but I think that's just not true. They're private schools. The tuition is paid through the property tax, and the decision is made when you buy a home in the suburbs at great expense. There's not public schools. It's absurd to call them that. They're limited to people who can afford to send their kids there, and the way you afford it is by buying the big house in the suburbs. So we've set up a system already, without regard to Christian schools, in which people who are well-to-do can opt out of the public schools anytime they're willing to spend the money, and they spend it heavily in order to move into the suburbs and in pursuit of the good public schools. And as I say this, I'm a public school kid. I went to bad public schools in some cities and good public schools elsewhere. But I was a public school kid and always in urban schools. But I think that this leads to my second point, that I'm not concerned only, when I think about what's a good and a bad school, I'm not concerned only about grades or test scores. I think that parents are acting within their parental freedom and their religious freedom when they make moral judgments about where they want their kids educated as well, a freedom that parents who have the resources can exercise. I entirely agree that for many parents, Christian schools have been an excuse to regain segregation in schools, but so have suburban schools. I mean, suburban schools have had about the same effect, and the median Christian school is actually more integrated than the median public school, although to be sure, that includes the Roman Catholic schools in that data, which tend to be much more reflective of the demographics of their communities than other schools are. But other than that small point of clarification, I think that we largely agree, including, I must say, I fully endorse the most important part of what I think Professor Johnston said, which is the dangers of living too much in the garden and resisting the call to the wilderness.
Thank you. Now there's opportunity for some of you to come and ask questions. Go ahead.
Dr. Carter, you opened up your lecture yesterday morning with a concern over two facets of democracy you see in decline, and one was the deterioration of communication and dialogue, and that is to be against something now is understood as wanting to ban something, and that was a frustration, and I thought about that a lot. How do I cultivate prophetic leadership, not in the electoral political realm, but how do I cultivate prophetic leadership and yet not be banning things left and right? And then you ended today with the activity of Christian community is to be resistant to culture. And I resonate with that, but I wonder, how do I cultivate my Christian community not in a way that's against an enemy? I've seen too many leaders and too many movements that are motivated against an enemy that have demonized something, and I don't wish to be about that. So I was hoping for more reflection on how do I cultivate my Christian community resisting culture and yet not claiming everything or looking for demons and everything and being so quick to ban, because I'm fearful that my tradition is well known for that.
You know, I'm just a simple country law professor. You know, you're surrounded by all these wise theologians and preachers. You need to ask them how to actually do the stuff. Lawyers have expertise at critique, not at solution. But I do want to say one thing just about the first part of what you said. I'll give you a simple example. For me as a Christian, I take the gospel strictures on divorce very seriously, and I think those are binding on me as a Christian. I know some Christians have another view, but in either case, I don't think that should be a matter of positive law. While I think that we as Christians ought to encourage people to stay together and discourage divorce, I don't think the government ought to do it. That's an example of a distinction that in Christian community, we can argue, persuade, correct people who we see going off in wrong directions. But for much of Christian life, that's the job of community. That's not the job of the state. And a lot of the powers that we cede to the state in America are powers of correction that might be better placed in Christian communities or other religious communities, but they ended up in the hands of the state in an era when people simply couldn't imagine the state ultimately standing for anything but a particular vision of Christian values, a bad bet, the mistaken analysis that I mentioned earlier. I wish I could say more than that, but the question of how one actually cultivates it, and this is of course the jackpot question, which I don't know the answer, but I know that one reason to be in seminary is to think about answers to questions like that, and I could use instruction on that myself.
My question is in regard to religious belief and political involvement. I think in many ways you could say, well, in some traditions there's been sort of an aversion or a fear of involvement. On another level, I think it's possible and easy to argue that religious faith should precede any political involvement. But the question I have is, given the nature of our society and our political system and our government, which is partisan, the question that is sort of troubling to me, or not troubling exactly, but challenging, is how do we understand ourselves as believers in a partisan situation, principally two parties, which both have merit, arguably, from a Christian perspective, but also do not have merit. I'm just curious as whether you have any thoughts on how we maintain and understand ourselves when we invest ourselves in situations which are not necessarily Christian.
Well, I'd be interested in a minute in hearing what Dr. Johnston, as a professor of theology and culture, has to say about that. For me, you've touched a point that lies very painfully on my heart. This is something my wife and I and the children have talked about, that I don't see anybody I can vote for this year, for example, the presidential election, as a Christian. I really don't. I look at the candidates and the parties and their positions. And my wife, who is a more mature adult than myself, is of the view that part of the obligation of citizenship, as well as of parenthood, is to vote.
Yeah.
And I, being a spoiled brat, I suppose, I look and I say, as a Christian, I can't find in these candidates and in the issues that concern them and in the changes they're likely to make, I can't find any significant distinction. I mentioned to some people last night that my wife and I spent a lot of time volunteering with the young people of a housing project in New Haven, and I don't think it's going to make the slightest difference to the lives of these kids who the president is, or even who the governor of Connecticut is. These kids' lives are not going to change because we elect a different Congress, and $1 shifted this way or that way, or somebody was the secretary of this or that. I just don't believe that American politics does that. American politics is basically, to me, a way of distributing goodies to the middle class, while protecting the rich, of course, but distributing goodies to the middle class. And it's not going to, and I don't say that, I don't have any particular left conviction on this, but this is my Christian conviction, you know, that it strikes me that those who are worst off in the society across a variety of measures tend to be unaffected by the elections. And to the extent that I try to cast my lot with those people, I don't see a difference that it's going to make who's president. But that's why I say it lies painfully in my heart. That's not a solution. I'm only making it worse. But fortunately, Dr. Johnson's here. He's going to solve it.
No, I'm not going to solve it. But one of the other comments I could have made is that when we think of theology and social ethics within the evangelical camp, there probably are four options. I wrote a book some years ago in which I looked at the editorial policies of Moody Monthly, Christianity Today, Reformed Journal, which is now Perspective, and Sojourners. What you've heard from Professor Carter is a Sojourner's perspective, and it has a theology behind it. It's a theology of creating the kingdom of God within your community and living out of that perfection. The whole Reformed tradition says wallow in the mud, and if you can move from 40% to 41%, it makes a difference. That's much too simple. But there's a whole theological tradition behind redeeming the time and creating the kingdom of God in increments. And that those who have that theological position will, in fact, look at the candidates. They might bemoan that neither are what they would like, but they feel called to make hard choices. And there are some choices between Democrat and Republican. When Ronald Reagan got together his cabinet, he basically said, the best way for the country to move forward is to reindustrialize and to favor the rich, and we will create an economic base in which some of us will get very rich and it will trickle down. And that's in fact what happens over the next 15 or 20 years. That's one approach. Christians can say, is that right or wrong? I mean, we can make judgments at that point based on our understanding of social justice, based on our understanding of the Christian's commitment to the poor, and so on. And we can differ. I mean, we can have reasoned dialogue, but surely we can come up with our vote. I'm going to vote for Gore.
I think you are the next one, really, although, and then we'll go to you, Tom. Good.
Hi. My name is Carmen Blair, and I'm the director of spiritual care education at a hospital called Queen of Angels Hollywood Presbyterian Medical Center, and I work with Azusa Pacific students and Fuller students of psychology and theology, and they spend their good time ministering to and experiencing the people in the hospital. And I thought a lot about coercion versus maybe assertion or invitation. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about your definition of coercion and your thoughts
about
that.
Well, sure. The way I've used the term coercion here is referred only to the kind of coercion the state does, that is the use of violent, the potential use of violent force. To be sure, there are many other ways we can imagine coercion than that, but that's the way formally I've been using the term. Now, to be sure, parents coerce children in a different, perhaps a different sense. Employers coerce employees in perhaps a different sense. And you can think, you imagine coercion in all of those situations. More formally, one can think of coercion as the exercise of a form of pressure that's chosen precisely because the person at whom it's exercised is unlikely to resist it in the service of some principle. One of the reasons that one has to be so concerned about government coercion is precisely because the government has the ability to strike at more human weaknesses, more different types of human weakness than other institutions may have the ability to do. There are certain things an employer can do to you, but not as many as the state can do to you. That's the point of the difference. That's all. But that was my understanding of it.
Professor Carter, let me ask for a critique.
Oh, good. I'm against it, whatever it
is. In light of your rabbi friend's belief, which you mentioned about currency earlier, I want to suggest that it's not the words on the bills or coins, but the Old Testament theology from Deuteronomy, which undergirds them. In God We Trust, in my view, says to the world that in those bills and coins, you cannot ultimately find worth or value, that money does not ultimately define who you are, that it cannot save you or even ultimately provide real security or length of life. And your thoughts on that? As such, I would argue it's a good theology and good politics that keeps those words on our currency.
Well, I am not an opponent of having the words "In God We Trust" on the currency. I think I have no trouble with that. But I think that the theology that you've expressed, while it certainly appeals to me, and I suspect to everyone here, doesn't fully answer the rabbi's objection, because not everybody is thinking that through as they contemplate what those words are doing on our coins and on our bills. So if everybody thought the way you think, you know, then you can see this makes perfect sense. It's very appealing. But since everybody doesn't, Rabbi Saberstein's point was that what is everybody doing then with these bills, and are they thinking of it differently? Moreover, even if one accepts the theology that you suggest, which I said I find very appealing, that still doesn't answer the further question of, therefore, now that we've made this judgment and we've affirmed it publicly on the bills, that we are not our wealth, we are not our money, does that fact, does that conclusion then influence the way that we use, that we earn, that we invest, that we spend? So one still has to, it seems to at some point, answer the further question.
Okay, I see there's four people waiting, and I'm going to play like an air traffic controller. They're ready to land. I'm going to ask no one else to take off, please, and we'll give a chance to these four that are sitting waiting, and I think, Henry, you're next.
Thank you very much. Dr. Carter, I'd like to ask for more reflection on something that I heard earlier in your speech today. I believe it was the point you were talking about, basically how beneficial religious variety, religious diversity is for democracy. One of the reasons I want to get to this point is a little while ago I had a chance to spend some time reading a book that I found was really important for me to read. It's called The American Hour by Oz Guinness. And Dr. Guinness is I had quite a time reading it. It took time. Dr. Guinness is a British sociologist who's now transplanted himself over here. And he said a number of things in the book, which some of which are probably pretty controversial. But I give him a lot of credit for one thing especially, and that is he spent a whole lot of time before he wrote the book in pondering the implications of the Second Amendment to the Constitution, and therefore dealing with the relationship between religion or faith and public life. And he came to, I don't know if conclusions, but he wrote out what he thought as he pondered that. And among the things he said had to do with the public philosophy, or the lack thereof, that allows people of faith in our country to live with people with no faith or some other faith. I mean, he was thinking of Christian faith and other faiths or no faith. And how we, since we haven't articulated that too well, we have real problems because we may end up just shouting slogans at each other. But one of the final points he made in the book, which I'd like to get at, is he believes that the discussion or the debate and the conclusions we reach over the relationship between those two things in our country is pretty much essential to the problems we're dealing with now. And he also believes that as a whole, the decisions that we end up making as a country about what the relationship between religion and public life is will be fundamental to determining the future we have. And he sketched out, he tried to avoid really detailed forecasts, futurology and so on, but he sketched basically sort of four directions we could go in, some of which are pretty dismal and some of which are either kind of neutral or one which is very beneficial. What I wonder about his point, and maybe you could comment on this, about how not just that religious variety, diversity is beneficial, but that it's essential, and it has everything to do with the future we're going to end up having as a country.
Well, let me say three things very briefly. One is that I, as I said, the American Hour is a wonderful book, and Os Guinness, who I've known for a while, is a wonderful fellow. I do think that, like a lot of books by Europeans looking at American society, I think the book suffers a little bit from a tendency to overgeneralize. And I think that there are places in the book, and you just mentioned one of them, where he looks at the way that we argue with each other and concludes that therefore we have trouble living together. But I think actually that Americans of different religious persuasions have been remarkably successful living together. Mm-hmm. We just can't, there are certain things one has to, you know, what Steve Holmes at the University of Chicago calls gag rules, that the cost of living together is deciding there are things we're not going to talk about with each other, with our neighbors even, which in some sense is too bad, but I think is true. On the issue of religious diversity, I mentioned yesterday, I wrote a little paper a few years ago about religious diversity and why Christians should be for it. But having said that, I don't know how to answer the claim that religious diversity is essential to our future without a deeper understanding of what we mean by religious diversity. I think that what is going to keep America from becoming a theocracy will be our tradition, our continuing tradition of having lots of religious dialogue. The more religious dialogue we have in public, the less likely it is, I think, that we have, I mean, this is a little contrarian, this is what I believe, the less likely it is we have religious takeover. The less religious dialogue we have in public, the more we have that risk. But the tradition of religious dialogue and diversity in America goes back a very long way. The Protestant sectarianism in America, while sometimes exaggerated by historians, has always been an important source of difference and distinction, and all those Protestants, with some important exceptions, managed to survive and to live together. I guess what I'm trying to say is this, that I agree that religious diversity is desirable. I agree that it is important. Is it indispensable? I don't know. It's not obvious to me that a society where everybody is the same religion is a bad society. That's not what America is or is going to be, but it's not obvious to me that it's a bad thing if, depending on what. But there you have to be more substantive and ask yourself, what religion are you talking about? What do they believe before deciding whether it's a good or a bad thing when you imagine such a society? But that's not America, and that's not my or most other people's vision of America.
Thanks. This past December, I finished 23 years of law practice in metropolitan law firms and small firms on my own. And I know that there are young men and women who are Christians that are among your students at Yale. And here you're addressing a group of pastors, therapists, and missionaries who will be ministering to those young people who are shortly or right now making the decisions about which major firms, how many 2,000-hour years shall they live, how to manage their families, and the things that you say to them and the things that you say to their prospective pastors, I think, bring or could bring down to earth some of the things you've been talking about, particularly today in terms of time. Could you reflect for a minute or two about that?
Yeah, Yale Law School does have a lot of Christian students, and there is a Christian Student Association with whom I recently actually had lunch on this to talk about this very point. That is, a lot of them, after or in the midst of their law school careers, they approach their careers in law with much trepidation. And the lunch was supposed to be an opportunity to reflect on how to balance, in effect, Christian conviction with the practice of law. And what's interesting is what they wanted to talk about was how to balance it in terms of what their clients are trying to do and so on. What I wanted to talk about was how to balance it in terms of life, how to balance it in terms of the amount of work. Law is a killing profession, literally. Lawyers have among the highest rates of suicide, drug addiction, alcoholism, heart disease. You go down the list of the kinds of things that destabilize people and their families, clinical depression, and lawyers are right up near the top on virtually all of those things. And this is what one of the things I've talked to students about over the years and made a special plea about this last time is that we can lawyers, like other professionals, become possessed by our work. And it's easy to put one's work ahead of one's Christian faith and conviction. It's easy to, in effect, make an idol of one's work, of the job. And that's true across a lot of different professions, not unique to law. But I think lawyers face a special problem there, not only because of the number of hours they're expected to work, but also because lawyers, whether you know it or not, are trained to believe that they secretly run everything. You know? I'm not being facetious. That there's something about legal education that makes lawyers decide that law is really in charge. That nothing matters more than what a court says or what the legislature says. This is the pinnacle of human existence, is to control somehow the output of the secular lawgivers. This is obviously quite antithetical to Christianity, but this is part of what legal education is and does. It's very hard to find, and there's a lot of Christians I know who are involved in a lot of law reform efforts of various kinds. It's very hard to find the one who will say, I'm going to step back and leave this in God's hands. It's just a sense you can't do that. I've got to fix this. It's my job to make it work right. And that's true whether one is doing law reform, whether it's in corporate law, whatever it may be. There's that sense that lawyers have. And you know that as a practicing lawyer. And I suffer through that a bit with my students. And that really is the biggest threat of all, I think. I don't know how to fix it, but I can tell I talk to students, including the Christian students at Yale, but not only the Christian students at Yale, about this subject with some frequency, because it's just something in legal education we don't think enough about.
This question, I would like to translate some of what you're saying about politics into the realm of culture, namely the education that goes on in Hollywood and TV and movies. And I would just like to ask, a lot of people here are involved in the film industry, and I know Mark has produced something even. A lot of people here at Fuller are wondering even if God hasn't brought them here partly to have an influence on Hollywood or to have some, you know, input in some way. And some people here do film critique that gets out and whatnot. But it seems like a lot of what you're saying here translates even from the realm of politics into how the nation is shaped by the thinking, and even international, the world is shaped by the thinking that goes on and what happens sometimes in Hollywood. And sometimes the Christian approach is like focus on the family or Southern Baptists to boycott or do other things. And Christians sometimes just see that their only power is to ban or to avoid shows. I wonder if you would have any suggestions about how Christians might, who are working in Hollywood, I'm part of two churches here that are doing that, Bel Air Press and First Press Hollywood, that are trying to make a difference in Hollywood and pray regularly and have prayer meetings just for Hollywood and the things that go on in educating our children and future generations and even influencing the world on how they see Christianity and other things.
I think it's a great question, but I'm going to let Dr. Johnston.
They hit me all the time.
Well, I don't want to answer because I don't know the answer, but I will say two things. One is that I'm a consumer, obviously, not a producer of films and television and so on, and I rely very heavily on reviews, both in the secular press and Christian reviews, specifically of films, before, for example, deciding whether to let my children see any movie. We do the spade work of reading reviews in the secular press and Christian reviews as well. Sometimes I wish that we'd gotten a little more information before we let our children see movies, but that's not the point. I think it's a mistake for the most part for Christians to take the view, as some do, that there's any industry they ought to stay out of. You know, we shouldn't be working in that one because they do all this terrible stuff, and in that sense, and that's where I lose the what was just described as the kind of Anabaptist flavor of my theology, because I think that while I think that retreating to the garden often is important, I think Christians have no choice but to engage with the culture on a number of different levels, and work is one of the places we engage. And for some, it's work in a law firm; for some, it's work in the film industry. There are all kinds of places that are seen by many Americans as having very low moral standards, and that's where Christians have to go. that for just that reason, you can't run away from the places where the problems are viewed by many as most acute.
Are you sitting in back waiting, or are you? You would like to ask a question or not?
Yes.
Okay, so we have two more, and that's it.
Okay, Dr. Carter, I just want to say I really enjoy your lectures, and especially today, because you touched on some things that are very dear to my heart. And I want to thank you for driving that nail of conviction further into my spirit. And I'm going to go home and make a banner that says, more time in the garden, less time in the wilderness. but my question is, I hate government politics, and I'm very politically incorrect. And I'm like you. I don't want to vote for any of these people who are running because I don't know who they are and they lie too much. But one of the frustrations that I have, and I want to direct this to you, Dr. Carter and Dr. Johnston, simply because, Dr. Carter, you're in constitutional law, and Dr. Johnston, you're an ordained minister of the church. Every election year...
That covers all the bases right there.
Right. So you guys don't have to fight over who's going to answer the question. But every year... the politicians in the African-American tradition enter into the pulpits to cast their votes. And I have a frustration in that, especially in California, because we're the proposition state. And how does the church morally and ethically deal with voter registration simply because there's so much legal jargon in the statement of the propositions, especially, let alone the candidates. How do you propose that the church should handle its congregants in updating them on what the propositions are really saying, and also how to discern the moral standards within the propositions in order to determine which way we are to vote? Thank you.
I thought that was the nonpartisan legislative analyst's job. The nonpartisan legislative analyst's job is to say all that, to do all that.
League of Women Voters.
Huh?
League of Women Voters.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't have that position anymore in California.
No.
The legislative analyst.
Do they?
Yeah, I remember that from my college days, but that's.
The legislative analyst principally analyzes the effect of fiscal and.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that's changed from my day in moral discernment and moral instruction, a church or faith community. That obligation doesn't change because something ends up being a ballot proposition or something like that. The obligation remains exactly the same. How to do it is, of course, the harder question. I'm wary, for reasons I expressed in yesterday's morning's lecture, of preachers trying to ascend to the pulpit and tell their congregants how they ought to cast their votes. That makes me very uneasy. Well, I recognize a lot of people do it, especially in the African-American community. I see that in my church in New Haven, which is a church in the African-American tradition. And often, it's very hard to navigate that line. I don't know how a preacher sort of balances there and says, I'm going to talk to you about morality and what Christianity, what the word requires of us, but I'm not going to tell you to vote for. And that sounds really quite disingenuous. Sometimes I suppose it is disingenuous. All which is a way of saying I recognize, and I should have said this yesterday, I recognize the balancing act I called for in my lecture yesterday. It's not easy to do. It's not an obvious, clear distinction. It's not always obvious when you're talking about an election and when you're talking about a moral proposition. I recognize that as a problem. I'm much more interested in calling pastors and churches and institutions and religious people to be sensitive to the distinction and to think about it than I am for calling for some sort of hard and fast rule. That's not really a direct answer to your question, but I don't know the answer.
That's fine.
Last question.
I had a question about the first part of your lecture today. You it was centered a lot about Christian community or Christian communities. And historically, from what I've learned, is that utopian Christian communities have not only failed, like the Puritans, the Shakers, the Quakers, and a myriad of others, but they've almost rotted away. So what I'd like is a clarification of what you would mean by Christians who are trying to retreat or gather together to put your children in schools or form socio-political clusters of sorts, and where's the balance? Because obviously, and scripturally, it's definitely, I'd be very hard-pressed to make an argument for like a secluded Christian community, rather a Christian community that is within, very visible to the greater culture, so.
Well, I think the point, one wants to be very careful here, and I'm glad that you asked the question. Let's say, we're running short of time, because I have three very, very quick things about it. One is, when I use the term community, I'm not always referring to something that's secluded. I mean, a faith community is what is how we come together many a time. Second, it was Paul Weyrich, not myself, who proposes the idea of seclusion. I try to suggest that you can never really do that completely, so I think I agree with the spirit behind the question. Nevertheless, third point, I do think that it is appropriate and to some extent possible for Christians and others at times to say we're going to take a retreat for a period of time or for a particular purpose. And when I refer to things like raising children in a sheltered community, that doesn't mean that the adults are as sheltered as the children are, nor does it mean the community is necessarily geographically segregated. I've known many Christians who homeschool their children or send them to Christian schools, but live in communities that are quite integrated in different faith traditions and different people, and yet they have the sense they're building a moral cocoon around their children. To some extent, I think they're right.
Thank you all, and thank Dr. Carter. Thank you. Let me wait. When we're thanking people, I want to make one other acknowledgement, and that is Kim Kosakowski has been behind all of this, and more than any other single person, she has brought together these Payton lectures. I would like us to give her a public applause.